Russell Brand, who are you to edit a political magazine?
Well, I just suppose like a person who's been politely asked by an attractive woman. I don't know what the typical criteria is. I don't know many people that edit political magazines. Boris, he used to do one, didn't he? So I'm a person with crazy hair, quite a good sense of humour. Don't know much about politics, I'm ideal.
But is it true you don't even vote?
Yeah, no, I don't vote.
Well, how do you have any authority to talk about politics then?
Well, I don't get my authority from this pre-existing paradigm, which is quite narrow and only serves a few people. I look elsewhere for alternatives that might be of service to humanity. Alternate means alternate political systems.
They being?
Well, I've not invented it yet, Jeremy. I had to do a magazine last week. I've had a lot on my plate. But here's the thing that it shouldn't do. Shouldn't destroy the planet. Shouldn't create massive economic disparity. Shouldn't ignore the needs of the people. The burden of proof is on the people with the power, not people like doing a magazine.
How do you imagine the people get power?
Well, I imagine there are sort of hierarchical systems that have been preserved through generations.
They get power by being voted in.
Well,
that's
say
how
that,
they
Jeremy,
get it. You can't even be asked to vote.
It's quite a narrow, prescriptive parameter that changes within the.
In a democracy, that's how it works.
Well, I don't think it's working very well, Jeremy. Given that the planet is being destroyed, given that there is economic disparity of a huge degree, what are you saying? There's no alternative. There's no alternative.
No, I'm
just
not
this
saying
system.
That. I'm saying if you Brilliant. Can't be asked to vote, why should we be asked to listen to your political point of view?
You don't have to listen to my political point of view, but it's not that I'm not voting out of apathy. I'm not voting out of absolute indifference and weariness and exhaustion from the lies, treachery, deceit of the political class that has been going on for generations now, and which has now reached fever pitch, where we have a disenfranchised, disillusioned, despondent underclass that are not being represented by that political system. So voting for it is tacit complicity with that system, and that's not something I'm offering up.
Well, why don't you change it then?
I'm trying to.
Well, why don't you start by voting?
I don't think it works. People have voted already, and that's what's created the current paradigm.
When did you last vote?
Never.
You've never, ever voted?
No. Do you think that's really bad?
So you struck an attitude, what, before the age of 18?
Well, I was busy being a drug addict at that point because I come from the kind of social conditions that are exacerbated by an indifferent system that really just administrates for large corporations and ignores the population that
well,
it was voted in to serve.
You're blaming the political class for the fact you had a drug problem?
No, no, no. I'm saying I was part of a social and economic class that is underserved by the current political system, and drug addiction is one of the problems it creates when you have huge, underserved, impoverished populations. People get drug problems and also don't feel like they want to engage with the current political system because they see that it doesn't work for them. They see that it makes no difference. They see that they're not served.
Well, of
I say
it
that
doesn't
the apathy,
work for them if they don't bother to vote.
Jeremy, my darling, I'm not saying that the apathy doesn't come from us, the people. The apathy comes from the politicians. They are apathetic to our needs. They're only interested in servicing the needs of corporations. Look at what, ain't the Tories going to court and to taking the EU to court because they're trying to curtail bank bonuses? Is that what's happening at the moment in our country? It is, isn't it?
Yeah, there is.
So what am I going to tune in for that?
You don't believe in democracy. No, you want a revolution, don't you?
The planet is being destroyed. We are creating an underclass. We are exploiting poor people all over the world. And the genuine, legitimate problems of the people are not being addressed by our political class.
All of those things may be true.
They are true.
But you took... I wouldn't argue with you about many of them.
Well, how come I feel so cross with you? It can't just be because of that beard. It's gorgeous.
It's possibly because...
And if the Daily Mail don't want it, I do. I'm against them. Grow it longer. Tangle it into your armpit hair.
You are a very trivial man.
What, do you think I am trivial?
Yes.
A minute ago, you were having a go at me because I want a revolution. Now
no,
I'm trivial.
I'm not having a go at you because you want a revolution. Many Good. People want a revolution, but I'm asking you what it will be like.
Well, I think what it won't be like is a huge disparity between rich and poor, where 300 Americans have the same amount of wealth as the 85 million poorest Americans, where there is an exploited and underserved underclass that are being continually ignored, where welfare is slashed while Cameron and Osborne go to court to defend the rights of bankers to continue receiving to their bonuses. That's all
what's,
I'm saying.
What's the scheme? That's all I'm asking. What's the scheme? You talk vaguely about revolution. What is it?
I think a socialist egalitarian system based on the massive redistribution of wealth, heavy taxation of corporations and massive responsibility for energy companies and any company that's exploiting the environment. I think they should be... I think the very concept of profit should be hugely reduced. Okay. David Cameron says profit isn't a dirty word. I say profit is a filthy word because wherever there is profit, there is also deficit. And this system currently doesn't address these ideas. And so why would anyone vote for it? Why would anyone be interested in it?
Who would levy these taxes?
I think we do need to, there needs to be a centralised administrative system, but built
the government.
On...
Yes, there needs to be a government.
Well, maybe call it something else. Call them like the admin bods, right. So they don't get ahead of themselves.
And how would they be chosen?
Jeremy, don't ask me to sit here in an interview with you in a bloody hotel room and devise a global utopian system. I'm merely pointing out that the
You're
current...
You're calling for revolution.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. I'm calling for change. I'm calling for genuine alternatives.
But there are many people who would agree with you.
Good.
The current system is not engaging with all sorts of problems, yes. And they feel apathetic, really apathetic.
Yes.
But if they were to take you seriously... And not to vote.
Yeah, they shouldn't vote. They should. That's one thing they should do. Don't bother voting. Because then when it reaches, there's a point. So these little valves, these sort of like little cosy little valves of recycling and Prius and like, you know, turn up somewhere. It stops us reaching the pit point where you think, oh, this is enough now. Stop voting. Stop pretending. Wake up. Be in reality now. Time to be in reality now. Why vote? We know it's not going to make any difference. We know that already. So, you know, I have more impact at West Ham United, cheering them on. And they lost the City, unnecessarily, sadly.
Okay, well, now you're being facetious.
Well, facetiousness has as much value as seriousness. I think you're making the mistake of mistaking seriousness
for
solemnity.
You're not going to solve world problems by facetiousness. That's...
We're not going to solve them with the current system. At least facetiousness is funny.
Sometimes.
Yeah, sometimes, Jeremy. So listen, so let's approach this optimistically. You've spent your whole career berating and haranguing politicians, and then when, like me, a comedian goes, yeah, they're all worthless, what's the point in engaging with any of them? You sort of have a go at me because I'm not poor anymore.
Well, no, I'm not having a go at you about that. I'm just asking you why we should take you seriously when you're so unspecific.
You don't have to take... Firstly, I don't mind if you take me seriously. I'm here just to draw attention to a few ideas. I just want to have a little bit of a laugh. I'm saying there are people with alternative ideas that are far better qualified than I am, and far better qualified, more importantly, than the people that are currently doing that job. Because they're not attempting to solve these problems. They're not. They're attempting to placate the population. The measures that are currently being taken around climate change are indifferent, will not solve the, problem.
It's possible as human beings they're simply overwhelmed by the scale of the problem.
Not really. Well, possibly it might be that. I mean, but that's sort of just semantics, really. Whether they're overwhelmed by it or tacitly maintaining it because of habitual life. I mean, like, mate, this is what I noticed when I was in the Houses of Parliament. It's decorated exactly the same as Eton. It's decorated exactly the same as Oxford. So a certain type of people goes in there and thinks, oh, this makes me nervous. And another type of people go in there and go, this is how it should be. And I think that's got to change now. We can no longer have erroneous, duplicitous systems held in place unless it's for the only systems that serve the planet and serve the population of the planet can be allowed to survive. Not ones that serve elites, be they a political or corporate elites. And this is what's currently happening.
You don't really believe that.
I completely believe it. Don't look at me all weary, like you're at a fireside with a pipe in your beard.
I mean, Ed Miliband was an elite.
Well, he went to the same primary school as Boris, though, didn't he?
He did, but he then went to a comprehensive school in North London.
Well, that's very good.
That's all well and good. But what I'm saying is that within the existing paradigm, the change is not dramatic enough, not radical enough. So you can well understand public disturbances and public dissatisfaction when there are not genuine changes and genuine alternatives being offered. I say when there is a genuine alternative, a genuine option, then vote for that. But until then, don't bother. Why pretend? Why be complicit in this ridiculous illusion?
Because by the time somebody comes along, you might think it worth voting for, it may be too late.
I don't think so, because the time is now. These movements are already occurring. It's happening everywhere. We're in a time where communication is instantaneous and there are communities all over the world. The Occupy movement made a difference, even if only in that it introduced to the popular public lexicon the idea of the 1% versus the 99%. People for the first time in a generation are aware of massive corporate and economic exploitation. These things are not nonsense. These subjects are not being addressed. No one's doing anything about tax havens. No one's doing anything about their political affiliations and financial affiliations of the Conservative Party. So until people start addressing things that are actually real, why wouldn't I be facetious? Why would I take it seriously? Why would I encourage a constituency of young people that are absolutely indifferent to vote? Why would we? Aren't you bored? Aren't you more bored than anyone? Ain't you been talking to them year after year, listening to their lies, their nonsense? Then it's this one gets in, then it's that one getting in. But the problem continues. Why are we going to continue to contribute to this facade?
I'm surprised you can be facetious when you're that angry about it.
Yeah, I am angry. I am angry. Because for me, it's real. Because for me, it's not just some peripheral thing that I turn up once in a while to a church fate for. For me, this is what I come from. This is what I care about.
Do you see any hope?
Remember that? Yeah, totally. There's going to be a revolution. It's totally going to happen. I think not only I ain't got a flicker of doubt. This is the end. This is time to wake up. I remember I see you in that program where you look at your ancestors and you saw that while your grandmother had to brass herself or got fucked over by the aristocrats who ran her gaff, you cried because you knew that it was unfair and unjust. And that was, what was that, a century ago? That's happening to people now. I just come from a woman who's being treated like that. I've just been talking to a woman today who's being treated like that. So if we can engage that feeling, instead of some moment of lachrymose sentimentality trotted out on the TV for people to pour over emotional porn, if we can engage that feeling and change things, why wouldn't we? Why is that naive? Why is that not my right because I'm an actor? I mean, I've taken the right. I don't need the right from you. I don't need the right from anybody. I'm taking it.
The title of this presentation is The Big Question, Environmental Misalignment and the Value War. Human society today has two diametrically opposed systems of economy. One is our traditionally imposed mode of monetary market economics. The other is a physical rule structure emerging from our growing scientific recognition of reality, both environmentally and sociologically. The consequence is an ever-increasing level of social destabilization and an ongoing decline in public health. I've divided this into two brief sections. The first part is called System Clash, Market Efficiency versus Technical Efficiency. To part two, Value Wars, Societal Potential Collapse and Transition, what we're capable of doing, what's in store for us if we don't, how we can get out of this system, etc. Before we begin, part one, economy. What is economy? It's defined in Greek as the management of a household, a definition that's often lost. To economize, what does that mean? It means to increase efficiency. Keep that in mind. Reducing waste. That's what an economy is supposed to be. Defining my terms. We're going to use two terms throughout this presentation. The first is a theoretical notion of an earth economy, which I'll define as decisions made directly based upon scientific understandings as they relate to optimized habitat management and human health. Production and distribution is regulated by the most technically efficient and sustainable approaches known. Compared to our currently existing market economy, defined, decisions are based on independent human actions through the vehicle of monetary exchange, regulated by the pressures of supply and demand. Production and distribution is enabled by the buying and selling of labor and material provisions with the motivations of a person or a group, the self-interest, as the defining attribute of unfolding. This is a chart of seven economic attributes, many more, but this is what I wanted to focus on here. Basically, they are intrinsic to each economy in comparison. Obviously, I'm focusing on the market economy and its relationship to a natural system, what we're calling the earth economy. The only caveat here with these asterisks are elements of our sociological development based on scientific integrity, scientific ingenuity, the evolution of science and our knowledge of ourselves and the environment. That will be talked about as we go along, as we touch upon each one of these. First point, consumption. In a market economy, the entire thing is based on consumption. The only reason that you're wearing clothes, the only reason you're eating, the only reason that you have a home is because someone somewhere is buying a service or getting a service, exchanging money in some form and consuming. That's what this system is. What does the natural world have to say about that? What does an earth economy have to say? Well, in all reason, the earth is a finite closed system. Preservation, not consumption, should be the ethos. If you lived on an island with a small group of people and you had a finite amount of resources with a natural generation of growth, a very simplified society, would you decide to make an economic system that tried to use it up as fast as possible? No, and I'm afraid the earth is an isolated island in a vast sea, a cosmic sea, if you will, and is a lot smaller than we think. Point two, obsolescence. The market system is driven explicitly by obsolescence. Two, intrinsic obsolescence. Intrinsic obsolescence being the use of cost efficiency, meaning that every good produced has to be inferior the moment it's made because the corporate institutions must save money at the very beginning of production to remain competitive against everyone else that's competing. Planned obsolescence, which is much more insidious, which is basically a form of fraud, even though it's completely codified and formalized as a marketing tactic, basically designs goods to break down under the assumption of repeat purchases. And it's truly amazing that this exists at all. And what does nature have to say about this? Well, building upon what we have just stated, it's environmentally irresponsible to design goods to fail or allow them to fail unnecessarily. That is basically offensive. We need optimum design to have things last, survive. Point three, property. The ownership metaphysic is a core premise allowing controlled restriction of resources and goods. I say metaphysic because property isn't real. There's no such thing of ownership in the broad scheme, not either intellectual or physical goods. It's all transient. The idea of everyone owning one of everything, for example, does that make a lot of sense when we think about our natural economy? What about the use of goods? What about access? The natural environment demands access. Universal property is inefficient. Strategic access is more environmentally responsible as a model and more socially efficient. If you have a car that you drive maybe 40% of the time, why not let the other 60% be used by somebody else? You create a system of access and use that's environmentally responsible. Point four, growth. Building on consumption once again. The market economy requires near constant growth to maintain employment. This ties in a little bit with the growth of population as well. But you always hear about this in, you know, the government. We have growth, we need more growth, the GDP, we're lacking growth. It's basically just absurd. We need a steady state economy. The Earth is a finite system once again. Earth demands a balanced load economy, respecting dynamic equilibrium, where things come together in balance, not the necessity to exhaust just to, say, maintain labor. Point five, competition. This inches into our new sociological developments that aren't talked about enough. Market system economy based upon personal and corporate competition in the open market, selling your labor, competing for market share. That's a completely metaphysical notion if you think about it, based on an early tribalistic form of scarcity and this notion that we can't possibly get along, there can't possibly be enough to go around, so we have to fight for everything and everything's out for themselves. What we've come to find is that human collaboration actually is at the core of all invention. It's called usufruct. And psychological studies now show long-term distortion with a competitive view. The great amount of distortion, corruption, crime you see, all you hear the headlines, white collar, blue collar, all comes from this primitive notion of a competitive environment, and nothing is held as sacred. Point six, labor for income. Human survival is today contingent upon one's ability to obtain employment and enable sales. That's your right to life. If you can't get labor, you might as well die because you don't serve an economically efficient role. What does this mean to our development in science and technology? Mechanization is incredible. The advent of automation is making human employment more scarce at a minimum and possibly obsolete entirely. Mechanization is also more productive and efficient than human labor, which means it's socially irresponsible for us not to mechanize and enjoy the fruits of the abundance and ease and safety it can create. Scarcity and imbalance. Contrary to what most think, money and the movement of money that generates consumption economy is explicitly based on imbalance and inefficiency. It's really an inefficiency economy, an anti-economy. The poverty you see, everything, and the disimbalance, that's not just some byproduct or a result of some greed institution or something like that. That is inherent to the system. The system wouldn't work if it was efficient and there was a balance in any element of human survival. Why would we want that? Abundance, equality. New sociological studies have found that equality is much more positive to public health. You compare the United States, a highly stratified society with deep imbalance, to Norway and Sweden that have much less levels of stratification. The public health in those less stratified societies blow us out of the water. Why not work to create an abundance through all these mechanisms of efficiency that technology now enables to meet human needs, reduce crime, all sorts of other obvious sociological phenomena? Spectrum of social disorder, and there it is. You have a macro socioeconomic system, macroeconomic element that is basically funneling out this distortion from childhood all the way through every level of sociological exhibition, if you will. And everything you see is coming from this very sick distortion premise of economy. My interest, ultimately, relationship of macroeconomics to sociology. Part two, change, value wars, societal potential collapse and transition. Over here are a series of social problems that you would see in the newspapers, very obvious: abject poverty, unemployment, destabilization, debt collapse, pollution, waste, all of which are completely technically obsolete. None of them have to exist at all. At a minimum, they could be reduced to a very core degree, those that are a little bit more subjective. Removing the environmental and sociological inefficiency inherent to the market and simply applying modern scientific understandings resolves or greatly reduces all of these issues. That is our potential. And since we don't maximize that potential, unfortunately, because of this framework we're in, We're faced with a unique form of collapse that many are not talking about enough. There's three nails in the coffin as far as I'm concerned. Unemployment, sorry to say, based on the way things are going, you're not going to see percentage employment levels that you've ever seen in the past for the human population. It's over. Energy costs, only going to rise from here on out. We live in a hydrocarbon economy. There's absolutely no investment or true intention of the government or corporate institutions to move forward with any type of renewables that will replace the current massive infrastructure we've created, and far too much money will be made as the system fails because of the scarcity of this thing. Debt failure. Am I the only one laughing at the fact that there's this fictional notion of debt that's like dominoes knocking down countries one by one? Transition. Here's the value war. Of all the times I speak with people about these issues, they tend to understand it, but they have these value associations that hold on to old artifacts of the prior system. It's a value war. How do we get from one to the other? What can we do to inspire change and create social reform? And that is the big question. What will you do? What kind of forum, what kind of social awareness, what kind of role do you think you could play? Are you going to maximize your own self-interest, or are you going to realize that your self-interest is only as good as the integrity of society as a whole, where self-interest must become social interest in order for us to survive? That is the new equation, and that is the big question. Thank you very much. Yeah.